Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to today's webinar presented by Biognosys. Today, it's my pleasure to introduce Stefan Michalik as a guest presenter. Stefan will describe some of his work he has done using data-independent acquisition mass spectrometry together with Spectronaut Pulsar. Stefan, a quick introduction to Stefan. He obtained his PhD in 2012 from the University of Greifswald in molecular microbiology and has been since working as a postdoc at the University of Greifswald and is now postdoc in the functional genomics unit at the University Medicine Greifswald. For now, this is enough for me. I will hand over now to Stefan, who's presenting his exciting work. And as always in our webinars, at the end of the presentation, you have time to ask questions either about Stefan's work or if you have questions about Biognosys products, I'll also be here to answer any of these questions. The floor is yours, Stefan.
Thanks for the kind introduction and giving me the opportunity to present our latest research in the webinar. I'm already indicated that I work in the functional genomics department, University of Greifswald, which is located at the Baltic Sea in the north of Germany. And today I will talk about characterization of bacteria-centric host pathogen interactions using data-independent mass spectrometry from technical development to infection experiments. I divided the presentation into a more technical part biology part. So I will begin now with the introduction to Staphylococcus aureus, which is one of our research focuses. Staphylococcus aureus is a globular bacteria and had a diameter of 0.8 to 1.2 micrometers and is a gram-positive bacterium. It's facultative anaerobe, non-spirulating, non-motile, and highly resistant to various stresses. Approximately 20 to 30% of the healthy people carry as aureus, and it causes serious infections. And as aureus causes also a range of illnesses from skin and wounds infections to pneumonia and bloodstream infections. The CDC ranked the bacteria as a serious concern, and around 80,000 severe MRSA infections and 11,000 deaths from MRSA per year occur in the USA. So as aureus is a very potent pathogen and has several weapons. So as aureus, its pigmentation protects the pathogen against reactive oxygen species. Adherence factors allowing a host defense escape via internalization, which is also depicted in the live cell imaging movie on the right side, intercellular grown bacteria marked in green. And protein A can bind the Fc gamma part of our IgG and allow escape from the immune system. It has superantigens, which activate T cell and antibody presenting cells, several extracellular enzymes like proteases, nucleases, which cleaves host molecules, efficient iron acquisition systems, are several proteins which are modulating the host, for example, skin and EFB, which are inhibiting the complement system, and cytolytic toxins, which are inducing the lysis of host cells. In order to study Staphylococcus aureus with DIAMS mode, it is preferable to use an ion library. I will not introduce DIAMS any further, since I think that all of you know DIAMS and its benefit, but I would like to briefly mention them. So DIAMS, in contrast to DDAMS, is a parallel continuous unbiased process which detects more proteins and allowing it to quantify more proteins with little variation. for the results I'm presenting today, we used a Q-exactive mass spectrometer with 19 dynamic mass windows for the DIAMS measurement. And an ion library, as I already mentioned, is beneficial for the DIA data analysis. We built our comprehensive ion library with different samples using various of fractionation methods. We used bacteria grown in complex media and took samples in the exponential and stationary growth phase. The samples were mixed and fractionated using either off-gel isoelectric focusing, SCX, or membrane enrichment strategies. Furthermore, we use samples from an iron limitation experiment and recombinant proteins that we had in our department. In total, roughly 200 measurements were performed. But in order to get a high quality ion library, it is recommended to use retention time spike-in markers like the IRT. Most of the measurements were unfortunately performed without the IRT spiked in. So it's basically the pre-IRT error measurements that we did there. I will explain how we dealt with that problem in a minute. Let me first explain how we generate our ion library. We took raw files, convert them to ZML using ProteoWizard, followed by the peptide identification via the COMET search engine. The search results were processed in the TPP to do the peptide validation. The resulting file was furthermore processed in ProteoWizard with a FTR below 1% to generate a non-redundant Bible spec file. And the BLIP file was then used to build the ion library in R using the SPECL package. And of course, this branch here can be now, let's say, shortcut via the Biognosys generic file, which you can use in the recent Spectronaut releases. As I already mentioned, many measurements of the ion library were performed without IRT. To not measure them again, we use the idea behind IRT to align MS runs without spike in IRT. To do so, we performed some runs with our exponential stationary phase bacterial proteome mixture sample with spiked in IRT on our Q-exactive. Now, we transferred the retention time of the measured Astarios peptides to the dimensionless IRT scale. Then we used these Astarios peptides, which having now an IRT value, and find the intersection of peptides from LCMS runs without IRT, and calculate the IRT from non-intersecting peptides. I will explain the workflow in detail now. So we had some LCMS runs on the left side with IRT and generated a list of identified peptides and their corresponding IRT. We extracted the retention time and peptides from the LCMS runs without IRT on the right side and looked for the peptide intersection of both. Then we use the intersection peptides for additional filtering. In the scatter plot is a run depicted, an IRT run about 2 hours of gradient against a non-IRT run of 30 minutes. We used for the downstream analysis only peptides which are located in the 25th and 75% quantile of the residuals of the linear fit. The resulting peptides were used as landmarks for transferring the retention time from runs without IRT to LCMS runs without IRT. We calculated the retention time ratios between both runs for each peptide. This is depicted here. And use nonlinear fit to calculate the retention time of the intersection peptides. So in gray, you have the scatter plot, the point scatter before, the alignment process and after the alignment process. The retention time for non-intersecting peptides now was subsequently calculated by using the intersecting peptide below and above of the non-intersecting peptides, and calculated therefore the retention time via linear regression. So in this example, the peptide above and below the linear regression, and this non-intersecting peptide will then get the corresponding retention time value. For peptides which having no intersecting peptides below or above, we used the last 20 or the first 20 intersecting peptides for linear regression, and therefore calculating the retention time for the non-intersecting peptides. To evaluate now our strategy, we generated on one hand a library only for measurements with IRT. So having only measurements from IRT runs, and on the other hand, a library consisting only of calculated IRT values, as explained earlier. So basically, a library from runs without IRT, but the IRT was calculated for them. We performed DIMS analysis for both libraries and extracted the delta IRT, which is a measure for the retention time variation. And strikingly, we detected only an increased IRT variation of approximately 1 in the 25th and 75% quantile, which is depicted here in the box plot. So we get a very good result, I would say, from this kind of approach. The constructed ion library consists roughly about 2,000 proteins, representing 72% of the theoretical proteome. Since several SRO strains exist, we wanted to know if the generated ion library can be used for other strains than our SRO strains. We use a derivative of the NCTC 8325. And in this unrooted phylogenetic tree, here's our strain, you can see the variety of 46 strains that we use and the coverage of peptides that we have from our library. So we performed an in silico digest of 46 strains and compared the theoretical peptides of the digest to those in the ion library. And on average, 80% of the ion library is covered by the theoretical digest of other strains. Thus, the S-Arios fragment ion library constitutes a core set of assays which provide an excellent starting point for the use with strains other than the strain we originally use. You must admit that the viral parts of the proteome then of your strain, for example, which is not in the library, would need additional proteomic data to cover these strain-specific set of protein variants. In order to test if the addition of strongly different sample sets and proteome fractionation is beneficial for the library generation for a comprehensive coverage of the proteome in our bacterial setting, a library comparison was carried out between a standard library, so basically 12 injections of one sample, and a more comprehensive library, so adding all the fractionation that I already mentioned. The analysis of S. aureus grown in complex media, exponential stationary phase samples were measured in dia mode and analyzed with both libraries. This revealed an assay surplus of 24% when the comprehensive ion library is included. So with the effort of adding all these files, you get 24% more in data points. And this resulted in 12% more protein identifications. When the data analysis of 65 different diaruns was carried out, and these 65 diaruns containing different conditions, like infection setting, chemical defined media, and so on, this showed an SE surplus of 37% and roughly 20% more proteins. And therefore, we conclude that the larger ion library is beneficial for the investigation of organisms with a highly variable proteome available under different growth conditions. A protein example for these on-off effects is, for example, the protein SUKB, which is a TCC enzyme. And this is not detectable in DIAMS in the exponential phase when grown in complex media, but it's strongly induced in the stationary phase. In the Venn diagram, the assay identifications from three different sample sets are exemplarily compared. This illustrates the high proteome variability over sample sets like complex media in blue, chemically defined media in green, and infection setting in red. For example, on protein level, we could identify nearly 85 proteins only in the cell line infection setting. If we would not have included these proteins in the library, we would have missed them. The basic ion library that was generated by analyzing 6 DDA runs derived from the QXActive and 6 DDA runs derived from a Tibletoff 5600 plus instrument contained IIT peptides. The major difference between both devices are the mass detection and the fragmentation mode. The Tibletoff data are collected with CID fragmentation and the QXActive data with HCD fragmentation. Graf and colleagues stated that HCD and CID fragmentation are very similar in order to test, firstly, if an ion library generated with a QXActive instrument is also suitable for DIA analysis of data collected on a Tibletoff instrument. And secondly, if we can merge the MS information obtained from both instruments in one fragment ion spectral library for data analysis. And thirdly, if generated assays in the fragment ion spectral library can be used to analyze data acquired on both devices, we measured the same sample set, so TSB exponential and stationary phase grown cells in three biological replicates with both instruments in DIA mode. The ion library used for this approach consists of 6 DDA runs from the Tibletoff and 6 DDA runs from the QXActive measurements. To elucidate the potential cross-platform usage of an assay, a combined intersection ion library, this means overlapping assays derived from the QXActive and Tibletoff instrument, was used for the analysis of the DIA measurement. And this is depicted in the Venn diagram. Strikingly, the majority of assays, roughly 95% or 94%, was identified even if an assay was generated on the other instrument. A representative example for the cross-platform assay usage is depicted in this slide. Displayed are the pseudo MS2 ion chromatograms and the MS2 relative intensity correlation. Although different fragment ions are used in each assay, which you can see here, for example, the shape correlation is very high in the measurement from the other device. So when you look at the QXActive ion library assay, the QXActive measurement, and the Tibletoff measurement, they are very similar. And vice versa, Tibletoff ion library assay, QXActive measurement, and Tibletoff measurement. So they are very similar. An analysis of assay total peak area of growing and non-growing cells measured with the QXActive in DIA mode and analyzed with assays derived from the QXActive and the Tibletoff revealed a very high correlation between both assays. fraction. So when we got the log two ratios of the exponential and stationary phase from the Toporov assays scattered against the Q-executive assays, we get a very high correlation and basically the same quantitative measurements. Coming to the dynamic range of the DIAMS measurements for S-Aureus, it is very important to know how much material is needed for a meaningful analysis. The dynamic range of the DIA method was tested by an on-column loading amount series with a digested complex cytosolic S-Aureus proteome sample, which was measured on a Q-executive. For that setup, we used a 50-centimeter column. And of course, column length and loading amount should be balanced to your system. Here, the information saturation starts at approximately 1,000 nanogram. Yeah, 1,000 nanogram, 2,000, and 4,000 nanogram on column loading. The median total peak area were used to estimate the linear dynamic range that we have. And the linear range was obtained from 50 nanograms to 4,000 nanograms, which is depicted in this plot. Furthermore, a series of peptide extracts resulting from different S-Aureus cell numbers was analyzed in a Q-executive mass spectrometer. To date, very low cell numbers such as 100 or 10,000 S-Aureus cells are not feasible for global MS-based analysis. A meaningful proteome analysis can be accomplished with 100,000 or 1 million cells. Coming to the lung epithelial cell infection model that we have. We use an S9 bronchial epithelial cell culture infection model to investigate effects during the encounter with the host and the internalization of bacteria into the host cell. The cell culture model aims to mimic processes of human infection. To gain insight into the intercellular lifestyle of S-Aureus, especially in the lung epithelial cell environment, this is very important. A confluent layer of S9 cells is infected with a multiplicity of infection of 25 with an exponentially growing GFP marked S-Aureus. The mix is incubated for 1 hour in a CO2 incubator at 37 degrees. During this time, bacteria were internalized. After 1 hour of infection, the supernatant was removed, and S-Aureus cells from the supernatant were taken as non-adherent control, which serve as reference for the data analysis. Fresh medium was added containing lysostaphene, and lysostaphene effectively kills S-Aureus cells. Therefore, S-Aureus cells which were not internalized or released from destroyed cells were eliminated. And this preserved the cell culture and ensured that only internalized S-Aureus can survive. Samples were taken using Triton X100 to lyse the host cells, followed by FACS analysis and FACS sorting to enrich the bacteria on the filter and separate them from the host cell debris. S-Aureus cells on the filter were tryptically digested, peptides desalted and analyzed via DIAMS in the Q-executive mass spectrometer. While previous study only focused on the very first hours, so up to 8 hours post-infection, which represents the initial adaptation to intracellular milieu and initial intracellular growth, we also included later time points, so 24 and 32 hours post-infection. In contrast to classical in vitro shake flask experiments, cell line infection experiments are challenging because of intermixed host cell material, which can contaminate the bacteria samples even when purification strategies like FACS cell sorting are applied. The histograms show the log2 total peak area of ions for S-Aureus and S9 human bronchial epithelial cells in the samples from the saline infection experiment. We detect an increased human proteome contamination over the course of infection. So in the histograms, so this is really a pure shaking flask culture, really less contamination there, maybe creatine, for example, non-adherent, it's basically the same picture, really nearly no contamination of human material, but it will ramp up over the course of infection. We also compared the coefficient of variation of peptide and protein intensity data presented from the carried out from previous study that we did in DDA mode with DIAMS workflow. So it's basically from intercellular growing cells, this time point. So on the y-axis, we have the DDAMS, and on the x-axis, we have the DIAMS workflow. The two-dimensional kernel density is plotted in the color line shapes that you see here. A more reddish color depicts a high point density. A more bluish color displays a low point density. The vertical or horizontal black lines, yeah, these depicts the median of the y and x axis, and the diagonal of equal CV values in both approaches is shown by the dark red line. What we can see is that we get a drastically lower coefficient of variation with the DIAMS workflow in samples which are contaminated with human proteins. So we have the non-adherent control, which is basically not contaminated by human material. We have a little bit better in the DIAMS compared to the DDAMS, which is not surprising. But in the intercellular growing cells, so more like this, we can see a drastic difference between DDA and DIAMS measurement. Those host proteins in samples could interfere during the MS analysis and may cause problems in the quantification, because contaminating host peptides can have similar precursor and product ion mass values as the peptides targeted from the pathogen. To test the host protein sample contamination interference, defined mixtures of S9 human cell protein and S. aureus protein extracts were prepared and measured in DDAMS and DIAMS mode on the Q-Exactive, and subsequently analyzed with MaxQuant and, of course, SpectroNaut. The numbers of S. aureus peptide identification obtained in DDA and DIAMS mode continuously followed the mixture gradient, basically. Despite comparable numbers of peptide identification, the coefficient of determination of the linear regression model, so X dilution and Y axis peptide intensity normalized to pure S. aureus sample, and on that scatter you do a linear regression per assay, and this R squared was closer to a perfect linear fit in the DIAMS approach compared to the DDAMS approach. And strikingly, the median in the red dashed line and the red numbers of the normalized peptide intensity was closer to the expected value. It's a black number and the black dashed line. It's for the discrepancy for the DDA. And this basically was closer in the DIAMS when you compared these to the DDAMS. And with DDAMS approach, this basically showed a nearly twofold deviation from the expected value. So you have a higher, really a high variance there due to the intermixed human interference. In the DDAMS approach, the ions were selected in an isolation window of 3MZ in our setting. To determine if a human peptide ions in the mixture were interfering inside the isolation window, we used the ions detected in the DIAMS approach and searched for the closest human precursor MZ in an IRT window of plus minus one. For every detected S-aureus ion, basically, the S-aureus and closest human precursor MZ were then used to calculate the difference in precursor MZ, and as a result, nearly 86% of S-aureus ions were contaminated by an interfering human precursor inside the isolation window. So this is depicted here in the histogram. So we have a really high contamination of human precursors there in this RS ion window. Coming back to more the biology side, I would like to show you now the live cell imaging movie, which you also saw at the introduction that we carried out. And you see the gray shapes are the cells, and in green we have the internalized staphylococci. And the extracellular medium of the cell culture system contained lysostephene, as I already mentioned, to eliminate S. aureus released from the destroyed host cell and to preserve the cell culture. And this is visible by the sudden disappearance of GFP clusters, yeah, here. So they get in contact with the extracellular medium and get destroyed right away via lysostephene. And this enabled monitoring of strictly intercellular S. aureus over longer periods of time. And mainly non-growing intercellular surviving bacteria were observed in low amounts after roughly 12 hours post-infection. In the image montage, this summarizes the movie quite nicely, and the infection process and the growth that is going on, and in the red squares indicate the samples that we're taking, so 8, 24, and 32 hours post-infection. When we now quantify the GFP signal over each picture and do basically a mean GFP signal analysis over the whole time series, we could estimate the intracellular growth rate of about 1.8 hours of generation time. With respect to the physiological adaptation of S. aureus after internalization, two different intercellular states could be distinguished. So we have bacterial growth in the early phase. So this is one. We have growth, adaptation growth, then escape and cell death of the human cell, and which due to the lysostephene will also kill the bacteria. And we have a survival of slow growing or non-growing bacteria. And this we can see in the later phases, so 24 and 32 hours. So basically over the time, we have a separation of both populations. The data analysis now revealed significant changes of nearly 410 proteins in at least one of our sample time points. The proteins undergo abundance changes during the course of infection and were classified in three groups. So we have group one, proteins present in different amounts compared to the non-adherent control at all intracellular time points. And group two, proteins altered at 8 hours post-infection, so mainly intracellular growing subpopulation, and then return to control level in the late phase, so 24, 32 hours post-infection. And group three, proteins exhibiting different abundances at 24 and 32 hours compared to 8 hour sample time point. I will now highlight only a few examples due to time constraints for proteins belonging to each group. And I will start with group one. And there, for example, we have SAHPF, which is a ribosome hibernation factor, and this is strongly increased over the course of infection, and is very important for survival under unfavorable conditions by hibernation of the translational machinery and forming 100S ribosomes. And it preserves the ribosome integrity and is critical for long-term viability of this aureus. Then we have the SBN proteins, and these are siderophore biosynthesis enzymes and responsible for the production of staphylopherrin B, which is important for the iron acquisition. Proteins in group two, so altered at 8 hours post-infection and returning to control level at the late time points, are, for example, the protein FMTA. FMTA affects the methicillin, which is a beta-lactam antibiotic, resistant levels there. And its precise function is basically unknown. However, fluorescence microscopy study showed that the protein is localized at the cell division septum, and furthermore, FMTA is involved in the cell wall stress response. So also a very important protein there. Then we have the MRSA2, which is a methionine sulfactate reductase, and this is crucial for the repair of damaged methionine residues in proteins after oxidative stress. And it has been shown that cells lacking MSRA2 are sensitive to oxidative stress and exhibit reduced virulence in mice. And we have PFLB, which is a pyruvate formate lyase. It's a fermentation enzyme, and this is drastically increased in its abundance under oxygen-limiting conditions. So we assume that we have microaerophilic conditions inside the host cells. Proteins from group three, so exhibiting different abundance, only at 24 and 32 hours compared to 8-hour samples, representing really the difference between intracellular growing and slow or non-growing staphylococci subpopulation. There we have our, for example, AH, PCF and DPS, and both are members in that group, and both are involved in coping with oxidative stress. And AHPCF detoxify our peroxides, and DPS protects the DNA against oxidative damage. So we have really stressful and harsh conditions in the later time points for the slow and non-growing our staphylococci subpopulation. The last protein example that I show is CLIP-B. CLIP-B is a chaperone, and it's important for the protein disaggregation. And interestingly, in Mycobacterium tuberculosis, CLIP-B protects the bacterium against irreversibly oxidized and aggregating proteins by segregating them asymmetrically inside the cell. And this is crucial for the survival inside the host. To conclude, I hope I could show that the larger iron library is beneficial for the study of organisms with a highly variable proteome under various growth conditions, that cross-device usability of iron libraries is possible. Meaningful proteome analysis on a Q-executive mass spectrometer that we have tested have been accomplished with cell numbers of approximately roughly 1 million. The DIA-MS workflow is better suited than the DDA-MS workflow to investigate infection-related models or proteomic mixtures. Extended time window to 24 and 32 hours post-infection allowed identification of slow and non-growing intracellular surviving bacteria with increased stress adaption and a proteome profile indicating aggravated nutrient limitation. And these findings support the fact that this aureus adapts to a changing environment in the host with a variety of stresses. And last but not least, I would like to mention that all the DDA data that we generated in this study were used to create the Sorius Peptide Atlas, and the atlas can be accessed via peptideatlas.org. And this is a very valuable resource for the selection of prototypic peptides for SRM workflows or DIAMS workflows. And with that, I would like to acknowledge my colleagues from the Interfaculty Institute for Genetics and Functional Genomics in Greifswald, our colleagues from the Institute of Microbiology, and our cooperation partners from the ISB in Seattle. And I would like to also thank for funding and thank you for attention. And I would be happy to take some questions.
Thank you very much, Stefan, also from our side, from Biognosys. As Stefan already mentioned, we are now happy to take questions. They can either be addressed in the question section directly to Stefan or to me from Biognosys. And I think as people are gathering the questions, I'm probably going to start and ask one question about the peptides that you looked at between DDA and DA in this comparison about the CVs and the dilution. Did you look there only in peptides that were identified in both measurement methods, so basically the shared peptides, or in all peptides?
You mean the S-Oreos and the human mixture?
Yes.
There we looked basically for peptides that we measured with a Q value below 0.001 in each measurement. So if the peptide gets, let's say, out-diluted, if you have only 5% of Sorius proteome in the mixture, then basically a lot of peptides were missing there. And then these were not used for the plot there.
Yeah. Okay.
So no SPARs or whatever.
Yeah. So there's the first question coming, and it's basically if you've done any targeted assays like parallel reaction monitoring (PRM) or MRM to validate some of your conclusions.
In this case, not. We did not. The thing is, for example, for the interference approach, if you select more mass windows, and you're getting if you have more mass windows, so you have a faster machine, and you lower down the interference there, and this has been shown. And with the 19 windows, we have to use also a long gradient. The Q executive is, let's say I would say slow. With the newer HFX, of course you be more faster there. Basically no. But we wanted to keep that as, let's say, close to the experimental setup. So what the people are really using, I would say, yeah.
Good. Are there any other questions? If not, I have one question in between, as well as for the the data analysis looking at these interferences. Do you believe that actually the automated interference correction that is implemented in Spectronaut is helping there a lot? And if so, have you actually tested it by turning it on and off and compare the results?
I would. I did not tested that. I always put it in because when I manually inspect the assays, I can really see that even in a pure sample, sometimes you have an interference there, and this problem gets worse. I would say when you have, of course, human samples spiked in there. So that's why we put. Not that that off, but of course this can be done. Yeah. We wanted to keep, let's say, everything out of the spectral node, all the benefits, and really show that if you do the analysis right, and having there a very nice comparison between DDA and DIA, so what's possible.
Yeah, good. Then one of our listeners is actually asking the question if, in the end, if you can repeat if the Q-executive ion library is better for Q-executive DIA compared to the triple TOF run.
I mean, I would say like all the Biognosis webinars also stated, and all other guys doing data independent analysis. So if you do DIA-MS and set up the library with your specific setup in columns and mass spectrometer, it's best to build your own library. But of course, you can download this library and have a good starting point to use for your analysis. And we showed that you can use it also for the triple TOF and for other devices. But we think that when you have the measurements in your house, you should build, probably it's best to build the library on your own. But if you do not want to invest that kind of measurements, you should download in that and have basically also a very good identification right there.
Yeah, that's also to second that. That's definitely what we generally advising is, we call it, you have project-specific spectral libraries that you create on the very same setup. They're just basically delivering the best performance. And if mass spec overhead time is an issue, then you can either go for a resource spectral library, so download one of the public libraries, or nowadays you can also do just a direct analysis of the DIA data. I think there is pretty much the question we got so far. If there are no more questions, I would like to thank you, Stefan, once more for giving this excellent webinar to us, to show us what actually is being done using proteomics and data independent acquisition in bacterial proteomics. And again, thank you, and thanks all for listening. Have a good day. Bye.
Thanks.